Good morning. We continue our discussion of the French masters. Today we are focusing on Robert Bresson. But before that, I will just try to recap what we have been doing so far, characteristics of the French Nouvelle Vogue or the French New Wave. So, we know that the masters, we were discussing Renoir the other day, and they believed in casting non-professional, non-trained actors to get a kind of performance which was low on melodrama. So, that was one thing. They the practitioners of the French Nouvelle Vogue, as there was a group, and we have already seen, led by the critic André Bazin, who established a journal called Cahiers du Cinéma, and these filmmakers rejected the cinematic practices of the 1950s. Truffaut, François Truffaut, even went so far as writing an essay, and it's a watershed kind of a piece called Certain Quality of French Cinema. Okay, and as what is that certain quality or certain tendency of French cinema, and what is that focusing on big budget and big star cast films, basically based on these French classics. Okay, and when you adapt a novel into film, then all the problems that accompany. You have to cast big stars, you have to have big sets, you have to have backing of a big studio, and that is what Truffaut means by a certain tendency, a certain quality of French cinema. And these people, the Nouveau Vogue directors, they rejected these practices of the 50s. They believed in making low budget films, we have already talked about that, using handheld camera and shooting on locations. They came out of the shackles of the studio, so real locations, real people, and of course preferred natural light to studio lighting, natural sound to extensive studio dubbing. We have seen all this. Now, we are talking about a period, remember Rules of the Game was made in 1939, and we are talking about a period of that is Second World War. And this was a time when American films were not screened in France. Remember, there was a part of France which is called the occupied France. Occupied by who? Good, the Nazis, Germany, Germans. Okay, so American cinema, because America was supposedly the enemy, and films were their movies were not shown, screened in France. Now, immediately after the war, there was a huge demand for Hollywood products, and some of the much appreciated films included film noirs such as The Maltese Falcon starring Humphrey Bogart, Double Indemnity, this is a Billy Wilder movie, and Laura. Okay, so the Otto Preminger movie. So these were, they belong to the category of film noir. So, this term also was coined by the French critics, noir, and these critics, apart from being impressed by auteurs like Hitchcock and Howard Hawks, they also admired the techniques which Orson Welles introduced and perfected in Citizen Kane, which was made in 1941. So, the French cinephiles, the film critics, they recognized that a major revolution is taking place, which French cinema is unaware of, and they recognize that it is a key event in Hollywood, it is a key period in Hollywood that is going on. Film noir, the so called film noir, most of them were based on novels by pulp novels, as we were talking about yesterday, James Cane, we talked about Mildred Pierce, remember James M. Cane, Postman Always Rings Twice, and Mildred Pierce. Raymond Chandler, what did he write? A great movie based on his very popular pulp novel.
The Big Sleep.
Directed by Howard Hawks. We were talking about Howard Hawks. starring Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall. So, Dashiell Hammett, who wrote The Maltese Falcon, Raymond Chandler, James Caan, and their kind of heroes, their kind of plots. So, the Hollywood film noir combined the hard-boiled prose of these writers, the noir writers, with European expressionist cinematography. And all these immensely appealed to the Kier critics. Now, see, noir and the hard-boiled hero, they were extremely popular with the French filmmakers and French critics. Does anyone remember that key scene from Godard's Breathless, which is often considered as a homage to film noir? Do you remember, Azhar? Have you watched the Breathless? Is there any moment where
she betrays?
Oh no, that's Femme Fatale, all right. But a direct reference to film noir of Hollywood. Is there anything, any shot which you remember? Does anyone? You, do you remember? No? Okay. Hero, the great Jean-Paul Belmondo. Okay. He plays a very gray character, morally ambiguous character in Breathless. And his signature style is, he wears all those very stylish tailored suits, he wears that hat, and he is always smoking a cigarette. Hmm. Now, there is a point when he comes face to face with a poster of Humphrey Bogart, and the poster is from the harder they fall. Hmm? It's a film noir. And he just, you know, the look in Jean-Paul Belmondo's eyes, like pure worship. He is looking at his hero, which he wants to become. Okay, so, it is very clear that there is Godard paying homage to film noir. Okay, so, we have already talked about other features, employment of lightweight cameras. Why do we need light cameras as opposed to exactly handheld, which can be used to shoot on actual locations, actual streets. And lights and sound and all these equipments allowed the new wave directors to shoot in the Parisian cities rather and streets rather than in studios. The fluid camera motion, you understand, can anyone tell me what is a fluid camera motion as opposed to a static camera?
Well, the camera is moving like in a tracking shot.
Exactly, camera tracks. You know, we were talking about Max Ophuls and we talked about pan, camera panning the entire scenario. And then we have the fluid shots of Godard. There is a particular scene. Godard was once married to this beautiful actress, Anna Karenina. Not Anna Karenina, that is Leo Tolstoy. Anna Karenina, you remember? Okay. So, they made a movie together. I cannot remember the title of the film, where she enters a music shop, you know, shops which sell music records and etcetera, not CDs those days, but records. And she enters a shop and she says, I want something by Judy Garland. Judy Garland, Wizard of Oz. She was also a songstress, a singer. Okay. So, she is looking for some music by Judy Garland, and the camera just tracks Anna Karenina across the shop as she looks for Judy Garland on the shelves, and then she finds a record and she comes back and pays for it. Yeah. So, the camera follows her throughout, the freedom of movement, freedom of camera. So, that is what we understand by fluidity of camera motion, and this is a you know, camera is never still. And when you watch a movie like Mean Streets, for example, which we will soon be discussing after once we finish Hollywood, French New Wave, then we will be stepping into that area also. And Scorsese's Mean Streets, camera is never static, handheld camera, right? Has anyone watched Mean Streets here? How many of you have watched Mean Streets? No? I am surprised. Okay, we will do that soon then. Okay, Mean Streets is a textbook. Okay, I know you know all the greats by Martin Scorsese, Goodfellas onwards. Okay, so I think that was the year when most of you were born. Am I right?
91.
Goodfellas is 89. Yeah, so around that period. Okay, so coffee shops, coffee bars. Paris is known for its coffee shops, right? All those intellectual discussions, Jean-Paul Sartre and Camus having, we know those existentialist writers. So, the mises of Parisian streets and coffee bars became a defining features of all these films. Actors sitting, having tea, coffee in coffee bars on Parisian streets, okay. And handheld lightweight cameras gave the directors that sort kind of freedom to shoot on actual locations, which is that most recent movie by Mani Ratnam? I get that impression.
Kadal.
Okay. Has anyone watched it? How is it? Yeah, tell us why it's not good. I mean, Mani Ratnam is supposedly one of the pioneers of new.
It's a routine story, ma'am. It's just good business evil. Nothing like, it's not Alaipaide or Bombay level.
Mm.
It's just another basically story of good business evil and who wins. Mm.
Technically,
the camera and music are very good now.
Okay.
The story is very mundane.
Okay. Story is mundane, but technically, and who did the cinematography?
I think Santosh.
Rajiv Menon.
That's a regular. Okay. Fine. We talk about authorism, right? So, cinematographer and director, actor, Arvind Swamy comes back. Okay. Yeah, another feature of French New Wave cinema was that they did not believe in a story and believed in improvisation on sets. So, traditional linear narrative structure, the classic linear structure was completely demolished. And who were the people? What stories did they tell you about? And now think again, Mean Streets and Bonnie and Clyde and Easy Riders. What are they? Okay, the stories about the young and the rebellious, the misfits, the alienated hero. These films use the language of the youth. Watch Godard's Breathless, and you will feel that some of the things he tells his girl. Okay, they were scandalous then, and for some of us they are scandalous even today. Okay, and Breathless was made way back in 1960. So, using the language of the youth, heavily influenced by popular culture. What do we understand by popular culture? I mean, I don't like the way people use the word culture very loosely, you know, this culture, North Indian culture, this American culture, Western culture. What is culture? What is popular culture, to be precise?
Well, in common parlance, popular culture is used to refer to something that is not a classic or that is not enjoyed by a certain elite, mm-hmm. something to that effect. So, popular culture, say in cinema, commonly refers to something like Bollywood, or within India refers to the vernacular, which is considered for the masses as opposed to a certain strata.
Very nice. Now, see, popular culture, simplistically put, is that culture which is enjoyed by the masses, commonly accessible, easily accessible. So, we understand that R.D. Burman is accessible to most and Mozart is not. Okay, that's the idea. So, same in Hollywood. Rock and roll music accessible to most, whereas Beethoven wouldn't. That is the idea. So, in these films, language of the youth, street jargon, as opposed to very stilted kind of language that cinema used at one point. Think Martin Scorsese again, think Easy Riders again, Born to be Wild. Okay, that is the signature theme of the movie. And it, they are not using some classical strain of music. They are unlike Renoir, who begins his movie with Mozart. Okay. So, Renoir is still meant for elitists, for all his sympathy for the common people. But people like Godard, they broke away even from that. So, extensive use of popular culture, especially popular Hollywood culture. Featured existentialist themes that we will talk about, and acceptance of the absurdity of human existence. Okay. So, most of these heroes, think Truffaut's 400 Blows, think Godard's Breathless, Band of Outsiders, A Band Apart. You know, Band Apart is a movie by Godard, and it has been immortalized by Tarantino as?
It's a band.
Yes?
His production house.
His production house. Quentin Tarantino's production house is called A Band Apart. Yeah. So, the characters in French New Wave films are often marginalized anti-heroes, not conventional goody two shoes heroes, loners. They betray no family ties, behave impulsively, spontaneously, immoral and amoral, and are frequently seen as anti-authoritarian. And all these features are found in the counterculture Hollywood New Wave cinema, extremely anti-authoritarian. Again, think Bonnie and Clyde. Again, think Dog Day Afternoon. Yes, anti-authoritarian, written all over it. Mean Streets. Any other example? Easy Rider, of course, is a key text. And we were talking about Hal Ashby's Harold and Maude the other day. All these movies shake the foundations of a traditional way of thinking and attitudes and beliefs and morals. A general cynicism concerning politics, yes. There was a student revolution in 1968 in Paris. Are you aware of that? Student rebellion in the Parisian universities in 1968. Please look it up. Okay, it will fine-tune your understanding of this entire cultural scenario. Murakami, for instance, in Norwegian Wood makes a reference to that incident. Please look at that. What is Parisian student rebellion? A deliberate distanciation between the screen and spectators, often breaking the fourth wall. Godard's characters start talking to us, okay, breaking the fourth wall. Otherwise, cinema is generally considered to be consisting of three walls. There is no such thing as, they do not recognize. Why? Because they want us to become one with the proceedings on the screen. But when you break the fourth wall, you involve the audience in whatever is happening on screen and compel them to think rather than empathize and sympathize with characters. So, as Brecht rightly said, that people should cry with brains and not with heart. That was what the French Nouvelle Vogue aspired to do. Any comments here? Any questions? So, I am just giving you an overview of what French Nouvelle Vogue was all about before moving on to Bresson. So, ask me questions, please.
Ma'am, is Paper Moon considered to be one of these movies?
Paper Moon by Bogdanovich, yes, it should be, it belongs to that, it is anti-authoritarian.
Okay.
definitely.
The family ties were destroyed.
Absolutely. There is no such thing as family ties in the movie.
She considers herself to be the daughter of the guy. But
of the guy, okay, but that means you have the freedom to choose your own father. Yeah, you're not compelled to follow an authoritarian figure just because you're born in a particular family. So rebellion against that construct of family as well. She likes this guy and she says, okay, I want you to be my father figure and not anyone else. We are talking about Paper Moon. Also watch the last picture show, okay, Bogdanovich's again.
The same genre.
Yeah.
WhatsApp Doc.
Yes.
Is it also in the same genre?
It's in the same genre. Absolutely. Yeah. It's a comedy. It's a reworking of Howard Hawks' Bringing Up Baby. Bringing Up Baby is a nerdy, geeky kind of a professor, a romance between a geeky professor played by Cary Grant and a light-hearted girl, as played originally by Katharine Hepburn and in What's Up Dog by Barbara Streisand, and it's a romance between the two of them. Love story, although based on a novel, is quite anti-authoritarian, right?
Ma'am, the clear examples of new wave in French cinema and Hollywood cinema, how far do you think this sort of movement has happened in Indian cinema per se?
Of course, we had parallel cinema movement, okay, all those movies by Nehlani and Shyam Benegal, okay. So, do you remember those films? There is a movie called Nishant, okay, there is a movie called Manthan. Manthan is based on real people, shot on location, is based on that entire dairy movement, Amul, yeah, and it is set in Gujarat. Shot on actual locations, mostly with non-professional actors, and all the greats who starred in Manthan later on became pillars of arty cinema in India. Nasiruddin Shah, Shabana Azmi, Smita Patil, Girish Karnad, okay. But they were not that great, or they were not commercially successful actors when they were first featured in Manthan. So, Manthan is a landmark movie according to me. Before that, there was Nishant, okay, again by Shyam Benegal, Saeed Mirza, and he made a movie called Albert Pinto Ko Gussa Kyun Aata Hai. In Hindi, that means why does Albert Pinto get angry all the time? Angry Young Man, the original authentic Angry Young Man. Of course, we have our more beloved Angry Young Man, but let us not get into that. Okay, so that Angry Young Man remains, but Nasiruddin Shah was the angry young man in a couple of new wave kind of cinema, okay. And all these films adhere to all the conventions of Italian neorealism and French nouvelle vague.
What about filmmakers like Dibakar Banerjee?
Of course, now they are here and they are now, okay. So, of course, they are. I mean, Love, Sex, Dhoka is a very good example. Balki is a good combination of realism as well as commerce, okay. But then you have Santosh Sivan, who I would call poetic realist, right. He makes quite realistic films, but they are romantic, they are poetic in nature. So, we had him for one of our conferences and he spoke extensively about his style, his influences. So, one of these days I will show you the recording from that lecture. Who else is extremely Anurag Kashyap, yeah. His cinema is quite authentic. It speaks of the authentic people of India. Okay, very realistic, very much grounded in our socio-political ethos. So yes, and he often casts non-professional actors. I mean, you watch Gangs of Wasseypur, except Manoj Bajpayee and some of the actresses, none of them are recognized. I mean, Nawazuddin Siddiqui is big now after that, all those movies. Yes, sir. And he was definitely not cast because of his looks, right? Or star aura. or whatever.